tells a little story. Hope you enjoy it. Yeah. Yeah.
I'm George Leonard, and I think I was born as a performer. The name came, I think I was 12 or 13 years old, and I used to go to a place called the Tete a Tete in Providence. It was on Thayer Street, and it was up on the second floor. It was that was the late 50s, actually, so it was the end of the beatnik era. And the beatnik era was, cappuccino and fancy drinks and all kinds of, poetry and jazz. And this place was a little beacon for all of that in Providence. And so I used to go down there, and it was owned by a woman, we called her Ma Tate, who was, I guess, a woman at the time, maybe in her 50s, I would guess. She was an ex-stripper, back when, when stripping was, they actually wore clothing. And, but a wonderful woman and a great sense of music and art. And she started this place, and she used to like to sing, so I would accompany her on the guitar when she was singing. And she sang the blues, and that was always easy to do. So she started calling me Georgie Porgy, and so that's where I got my name. My mother took me down for lessons, guitar lessons, once a week to Pettirudi School of Music, and I would have my 1 half-hour lesson, and then I would practice. I guess I was pretty diligent, mostly practicing, because you could escape all the horror of your home, and we all know about that. now we go like this, At the time you practiced an instrument or did something different, That's what I did.
From there you started a band, and I think with your family.
My two sisters, Judy and Carol, Carol played piano, Judy played the bass. So we put together a band. We thought we were pretty great, I have no idea how good we were. But we were having, we were doing it. We were just doing it. So we would do little events. That happened a long time ago. I think maybe I was like 11 when I had that. And I remember doing the Celia Moreau radio show with them. I think we did Yellow Bird or something. And we played. And the most memorable event was that she also had tap dancers on, a whole class of them, because, Teresa Landry and Donna Carter, and there were all these, they all had, they still do, actually, some of them are ancient. As a matter of fact, Teresa Landry's still alive. So they would tap dance on the radio, which was hysterical, I remember we were waiting for our little part to come on, so we listened to the radio, what was being broadcast, and it just sounded like a rainstorm, It was great.
What was the name of your band?
We call ourselves Georgie Porgy and the Crybabies, based on the nursery rhyme, Georgie Porgy, when you kiss the girls and cry. From that time, I played with everybody's band that did a wedding or something. I either played bass or I played guitar. I think I played in a band called the Manhattans, and the Keynotes and all those silly names. I'm here in Attleboro, Massachusetts, where I went to school, and in 1964, I was asked to leave because I had long hair. It was a complete surprise to me. I heard my name on the intercom to report to the principal's office. I went to the office and I was told that I had to have my hair cut. Mr. Joyce told me to cut my hair. And I was perplexed at that. And I don't really remember what my conversation was with him. I only remember the feeling of the day, which was that I had never been talked to by anybody like that before, I started saying something, and he'd say things like, "Oh, you're barking up the wrong tree here," and which I had no concept of what's barking up the wrong tree, I was 17 years old. It's kind of stuff you use when you're old, all the cliches and stuff. I walked around Attleboro for a little while, contemplating it, whatever there was to contemplate, or however I knew how to contemplate at the time. And I just didn't have, I just had a strange feeling that, and I understand what it is now, like many years later, is I took it personally, which is not a good thing to do, take anything personally. You know, you learn this later on, but at the time I did take it personally. And I didn't know what to do about it, so for some reason I thought Attleboro Sun, because, you know, they report on things like that. So I took the Attleboro Sun, and I remember, I wish I could remember who did the article, but it's probably written somewhere. But we had lunch that day and had coffee and some lunch, and we discussed it, and I told him the story, and the next day it was, you know, completely in the front page, pretty much the whole front page, yeah. The family got involved, and we also got a call from Ernest Rotenberg, who was an attorney in Attleboro, and unusual guy, you know. He was spirited in the way of the 60s, you know, about, you know, liberties and this, and he was a young guy too, so of course there was a part of him probably looking to, you know, expand his name and who he was and, you know, what he could do. So he took on the case. I think he took on the case $500 for the whole thing, you know, which was, you know, nowadays it's $500 an hour to get a lawyer, you know, and you end up doing all this work anyway. Nothing against the great lawyers out of the world, all 2% of them. So we took it to him, and then there was a series of appeals and little court cases, you know, the smaller court cases. There was why I think I won one where I was allowed to go to school for 7 days. I'm not sure of the history. It's all pretty well documented. He took it as far as the United States Supreme Court with the help of another guy named Ed Dangle. I think we always felt that Ernie could have done it all by himself, but because this other fellow had experience in the court system, he wanted to use him. But I always think, you know, wow, Ernie could have done it, you know. He could have done it, yeah.
It says that on his behalf, his parents filed suit and argued several points, that although still a high school student, he had already established himself as a professional musician, and that the length of his hair was an integral part of his vision of being a performer.
Yes, yeah.
So it was personal, but it was important to you. It was your right.
It all started out, it's certainly you have a right to be able to you know, go ahead and be retarded because you took something personally, which may be more accurate. I know it's not really the kind of language of a hero, you know, but who is a hero? You know, we're all just fumbling around. You know, because you got to remember, I was 17 at the time, and if there are anybody out there 17, you really don't know what an idiot you are until many, many, many years later. And so you think you have all the answers. And at the time, I had been doing every kind of music. I hadn't touched rock and roll. Elvis came along and I had no interest at all. But when the Beatles came along, I was 17, which is a pretty formidable age as far as socially concerned. So I knew that if I played a Beatles song, you know, people would like me, and, you know, I might actually go on a date, whatever, you know, things like, you know, stuff you think about when you're that age. So I remember spending a week with the Beatles' first album, learning all the songs and everything. You know, it wasn't very complicated. You know, it was a pop rock group, and, you know, the music was accessible and done well, you know, done very well. And so I learned those songs, and immediately started getting all kinds of work. I mean, it was in school working 6 nights a week, I remember. Yeah.
You set a precedent. So what does it feel like when you see kids walking down the street with purple hair, or you were a part of that?
You know, I don't see it.
You don't?
No, I don't see a bit of it. I mean, to me, it was just, I just lived my life and that was it, you know? And I mean, I'm dealing with it all the time. I was just thinking about Mr. Joyce, you know, we would do these radio interviews, and, you know, I'd do mine, he'd do his. And I remember him talking about, well, if God wanted a man to have long hair, he would have made long hair, you know. And I remember thinking, all I could think of was the Jesus image, you know. And I mean, he was Catholic, or, you know, and I could never put any of it together, you know, because how can you put it all together? It's all insane, you know. Every second of this world is insane. My principal, Joseph Joyce, was the principal of a very, very fine school. So, I mean, how bad could he have been? He was the principal, right? I Googled him, and I found that he died last year. Yeah, he died, 2011. And while I was Googling it, I was thinking, what a nice thing to have been able to go out and have coffee with him and see if we could have a good laugh about the whole thing, because the whole thing's quite silly.
So if you had to sum up that whole part of your life, which really led you to the rest of your career, it did.
Yeah, I guess it sort of did, but in a strange way, because, yeah, everybody knows because of the hair, you know, but I was hoping that it would be the music, you know? But it just didn't happen that way, you know? It just didn't happen. You know, Peter Best was the fifth Beatle, you know? When we were all like one of us was the 1,532nd Beatle, and somebody was the 1,542nd Beatle. I mean, we all, you know, we were all, I mean, they had kind of paved the way for, you know, you could actually make a living making music, and people would like you, all kinds of things like that, you know, which I didn't see in the Elvis thing, but I was probably too young, you know.
Right.
So I got caught up in that. And now it's interesting to see that what the Beatles have brought to their legacy really is basically not that people sit around listening to Beatle albums, but I discovered that their real legacy is the same thing as like George Gershwin and Cole Porter and everything. Is when you're in a rest home and you can't remember who your family is, you can sing the whole song. And that's the truth. Yeah, if you go into an Alzheimer's ward and play music, they can't remember their family, but they remember all the words. And you can be sure that, you know, my generation, when they're in the rest home, and they're probably, some of them are already there, you know, saying, "We all live in a yellow submarine," you know. It's not a bad legacy, right? Guitar is my main instrument. And then I would say the second instrument is the bass. And then everything else is kind of like a bad aftermath of what I already knew about those instruments, like violin, some piano. That's all I would actually almost admit to, you know.
I know you went to school. Where'd you go to school?
Attleboro High School. I went to school. No, I went... when I was 15, my music teacher decided he couldn't teach me anymore, which wasn't true. I mean, he had a lot of knowledge, still had a lot of knowledge. So he sent me over to Berklee School of Music, which I lasted for, I don't know, 2 or 3 weeks, and I got so tired of that. And I just decided I just never wanted to go to music school, because I don't ever think I ever wanted to learn it. I just wanted to do it, you know?
You've had really quite a career. I read that you went to New York.
It's so funny. That's like a Rhode Island thing. Well, you had quite a career. You got out of Rhode Island, you know? Yeah, I did. I went to New York early. I was actually the first time I was in New York, I think I was 16. And that's because we did the World's Fair. I was with the Rhode Island Youth Jazz Ensemble, which was a great band. It was so good. And I think I played guitar and bass in that. I'm not too sure what it was. But later I played the jazz festival with that group when I was 16. And I was in New York early. And then I went to New York to play at Jack Silverman's International Theater on Broadway, which sounds really, you know, really, wow, Broadway, Jack Silverman's International Theater. Well, the truth of that is they were sort of like just being afloat. And I remember Minsky's Follies. You ever hear about that? Well, Harold Minsky used to come in there begging for the money because this place that I was working never really paid them, you know. So, you know, the picture of the getting out of the little town to go to New York, you know, it's just as fuzzy as anything you'd find locally, you know, just as fuzzy.
tell me a little bit about Miami.
Oh, Miami. Yeah, I could only tell you a little bit about Miami. I was there for 4 years. And I don't know. You know, I don't think I ever really wanted to be doing what I did. It's just like the idea of it, you know? And I liked writing the songs. That was kind of fun.
Yeah.
But the only way to make a living at it was actually to put a band together and go in front of people. So I spent a good deal of time on Miami Beach playing a tourist club, you know, with at the time, this was in the later 60s, maybe 67. The name of the place that I played in Florida was the Rec Bar, which was in the Castaways Hotel, which has since burned down. There were go-go girls on the tables, and there were, you know, cans that people could shake in time with the music. But also, it was a very interesting time, although I wasn't really aware of it. A lot of people stopped in at that bar. Anybody that was playing at the Peace Lovin' festivals, the rock festivals and stuff, they used to all stay at the hotel where I was playing. So they would always pop in, and especially if there was a festival going on, they'd all come in. Everybody wanted to sit in, you know, because they're just musicians, you know. Yeah.
I'm gonna read part of this, but I want you to elaborate because I flipped out when I read it.
Okay.
I mean, it's really exciting part of anyone's life. One memorable evening occurred during the Miami Pop Festival, which is what you were talking about. Jimi Hendrix, Frank Zappa, Jimmy Carl Black of the Mothers of Invention, Arthur Brown of Fire fame, John Kay of Steppenwolf, and the entire Vanilla Fudge Band were all staying at the Castaways, and they all sat in with the band during a single performance. Tell me about that night.
Now that was, you know, it was just another night for me, but it was kind of fun, you know. But I mean, they were, you know, it's like when I was in New York, I was playing the tourist place, but they were like at the, you know, Fillmore East, and that's where everything was really happening, you know. So these are the guys that were doing that, you know. I mean, the same as me, only we chose different venues, you know.
Did you ever keep in touch with any of them?
No. But I used to bump into John Kay all the time. Yeah, I'd bump into him all the time. Because most of them aren't around to bump into anymore, you know.
Recent thing was a Frank Sinatra, right?
Oh, that was Elvis Sinatra. I did that in the 90s. And had nothing to do with Sinatra or Elvis. I just thought it was a nice, interesting clash of generations because musically, there was the Elvis people and the Sinatra people. I hate you, I hate you, I hate you, I hate your music, I hate your music. You know, it was always like, because eventually music becomes elitist, like everything else. You know, whatever it is, you know, you talk to these guys that were, you know, 17 during the 50s, you know, they always go, oh, there'll never be no music like Elvis, you know. I mean, everybody's got their own, you know, take on this thing, you know. That's what makes music interesting, is that, you know, once the generation dies, that's it, boom, it's gone, you know. You know, well, a little bit, sometimes, you know, Mozart, you know, people that, you know, that, you know, few people kind of get it, you know, kind of. Usually music students, so, you know, what's the point?
Tell me about your cable show.
I started doing Commander Video in New York City, I think it was 1977. But that grew out of something that we were evolving with my live band at the time, which I think was the Bozo Band, which came after the Bozo Rock Opera. And we decided to try things like work with two screens. So I remember lifting these, you know, because in those days, a 25-inch screen really meant like 2,500 pounds, you know, I mean, it was huge. I remember lifting these two things up on the stands, and we would play videos along with the music. We try to sync them up sort of close. And that's what led to the Commander Video thing, because I started doing these silly little ads, you know, like exploitation ads for children. And that led into the Commander Video Show, which was kind of like a children's show for adults, you know. A very, very sort of, if you want to elaborate on it, might be very mild version of South Park, you might say, only without cartoon people. And that was a wonderful time because everybody was trying to do something in cable television. And everybody had some kind of a show going on. There were some wonderful shows. They were so, I think you would think they were wonderful because they were so bad. And there was this guy, Tex Fenster, a fellow in his 80s. It was Tex Fenster's disco. And he played records that his mother loved while showing pictures of his mother. And that was the whole show. Then there was these sort of pornography kind of things. They go into the dance clubs, you know, where the girls danced around, you know, sort of naked, and some were naked, and whatever. There was that. Then there was Julio Iglesias, Julio guy. And he was also old, probably in his 70s. And his thing was to sing in 17 different languages, which he did by putting on a record and then mouthing the language, sort of. And he would sing to, the studio would have a whole row of chairs with all women maybe in 70s, 80s, you know, they're sitting there like this, you know, with their legs spread apart. And he'd be just being so charming and singing to them. And it was just one show after another, after another, after another, one worse than the next, but just, your eyes are just glued to it because it was so, you just couldn't believe it was happening. I suppose that's maybe those were the forerunners of the reality shows. I also, during that period of time, thought I would become a stand-up comic. So I used to go into the comedy clubs and do that, but I realized how tragic that is. That is so pitiful. You see these, you know, the comedians, you know, they night after night after night, they shift a word here and they shift a word there and change a word, you know, and really, you know, like real craft about it, you know, but you really wonder why they're a strange lot, you know.
Where did you film most of your show? Did you do it in studio or?
No, I did it in my apartment. Yeah, we did it all in the apartment. We built a backdrop. Got some lights and had a camera. In the early days, the real cheap, they weren't even cheap, they were expensive, but they would have this thing called ghosting. And you move the camera a little bit and it would just follow like a ghost. That's the way everything was back then. So it was, you know, to have a real television show, you know, that was a lot of money. Now, anybody could do it, you know, just get the space, you know. Just like now, cable, you know.
Did you edit your own show?
What I did is I found some people who were kind of fans of the show, and they offered to edit it for me, which was nice. So we go in the studio. I give them a little bit of money, you know, because of course, you know, but it was a pittance compared to what the studio was worth, you know. Matter of fact, Larry Vanderveen was his name. Yeah, it was all mobile video, and their claim to fame was they had the original footage of the capture of Sam, Son of Sam. So that was their claim to fame. And I remember being in the editing room when they were playing their demo reel, which everybody had as, you know, to show you the quality of work that they did. And they were watching the demo thing, and all of a sudden the shot of the Son of Sam comes on, you know, and the whole place goes into applause, you know. It's a crazy world.
So tell me about the concept of Commander Video and the costumes. The costumes were wonderful.
Well, the concept of that was to be a variety show that took place from outer space. And it was a kind of a loose idea, but we wanted something so we could just go in any direction possible. We were writing two or three space songs a week. Amazon Woman, Incredible Shrinking Lady, Invisible Lady, Four Arms to Hold Me, a Menage a Trois for Two, that was one of the songs. Computer Masseuse, and silly stuff. But it gave me a chance to write songs, which is what I like to do, you know, so I had a place to put them. Now come to think of it, that's the only reason I ever did anything, was to have a place to put my songs. Elvis Sinatra was the same thing. I needed a place to put my songs, so I made Elvis Sinatra, and I had other songs. I needed a place to put my songs, so I did the Bozo Rock Opera.
Is that one-man band that I read about?
The one-man band was recorded in Florida when I was in Florida. also wonderful history there too. It happened to be the studio where Atlantic used to record everybody. Aretha Franklin, Stephen Stills, Ken Purdy, everybody, recorded everybody. So everybody would go to that studio. So I went to that studio because, and I can't remember, I think what it was is before I did the album, I had done a recording session in which I hired Jaco Pastorius. And Jaco Pastorius is sort of a god in the world of electric bass players. And of course, at the time, he was just a bass player. You know, I was playing with Tommy Strand, the upper hand. And we would all do these, to get in the Criterion record, we'd all do it for free, you know. But at the time, he had just had a kid. And he said, nah, man, I got to get $25. So I gave him $25, you know, because I was pretty rich. You know, I had a job on in Miami Beach. You know, rich is like a few hundred bucks a week or something, you know. So I could afford it. And I had no idea it would turn out to be this, you know, amazing monster of a musician. So I think that session kind of like opened up a few things because the engineers thought he was absolutely fantastic. Well, they didn't think he was great. They actually ended up buying his bass because they thought that all the magic was in the bass that he had, which is really peculiar, you know? So they gave him, I think, $600 for it, and he went out and bought another one for $100, and, you know, same Jaco, you know. Yeah. But it's amazing about these guys that play. Same thing with Jimi Hendrix. You know, now you can go out and buy a Jimi Hendrix pedal so you sound exactly like him, you know. But he used my brother-in-law's guitar, and he plugged into my amplifiers, and he sounded just like Jimi Hendrix, you know. It was the sound in his fingers, you know. It had nothing to do with the equipment, which was nice to witness, you know. Same thing with Frank Zappa. Had the same thing as another great guitar player. But I mean, he was on any guitar, they're the same person, you know, any guitar. So sorry, Guitar Center.
That's perfect. I guess I'm gonna have you sum it up. I could talk with you for hours, seriously, I could. I guess I'm gonna ask you a question. You're still doing your music, that's never gonna stop. What would you say in your lifetime so far has been one of the greatest moments of your life?
This one right here.
That was the correct answer, Joe.
Once upon a time in space, there lived a little girl who had a dream that she would dance and twirl from world to world. I met her on the moon one night during her eternal flight. I asked her if she'd like a lift. She said her feet were lightning swift. Ballerina Borealis dance. Ballerina Borealis dance. Lovely ballerina, dancing with light. I followed her from Pluto to Neptune in one night. I asked her for her heart as she took another leap. She said her heart was mine, but her feet she had to keep. Ballerina Borealis dance. Ballerina Borealis.